time I do a deed I shouldn't do. Every time I say a word I should not say. Let me tell you what I do. It brings the blessings too. I just feel away somewhere great. I just feel away. I just feel away. And I ask the promised Lord to see me. I just feel.
Seven, not given to filthy lucre, or actually the first part of verse number 8, but a lover of hospitality. Tonight we'll continue on in verse number 8 and try to finish it up by the grace of God here this evening. Let's backtrack a little bit, and just for reminder's sake, let's pick up at verse number 5. The reason for these instructions being left in place to Titus is to go forth and ordain elders and have the proper leadership in our New Testament churches. Yeah. Beloved, that was necessary then. It's still necessary today, amen. But beloved, today in the age that we live in, where we're afraid we're going to offend somebody or hurt somebody's feelings, sometimes we've got to the point where we compromise some of these qualifications. And beloved, when you do that, you're getting out of the will of God, and God's not going to fully bless that ministry if you decide to deviate from His commandment. Beloved, if you get off on the beaten path and you say, well, I wonder why this is happening and why God's not blessing here. Yeah. It's because you're not doing it His way. Beloved, when this church called me 6.5 years ago, a lot of things had taken place and everything. And I was talking with a couple of the men that were attending the church here at this time. And they were very nervous about how much more longer this ministry would be able to continue and everything. It had gotten to maybe a point where some things were just getting I ain't gonna say out of hand, but just getting in critical condition, I guess, if you will, by man's point of view. And I just told them, man, I said, well, I'm gonna tell you something. We're gonna do things God's way, and we're gonna trust God by faith. And I said, if we do it God's way and put our faith and trust in Him, He'll take care of the rest of it.
Amen.
And 6.5 years later, we're still going by the grace of God. Amen. And so, beloved, when you do things the way God instructs, God will bless. It's just that simple.
Amen.
And it's just that simple. And so it applies to us personally, individually as children of God. Well, it certainly applies corporately, if you will, as a body of Christ, as a church. And we can take that and multiply it on out as a nation as well. Amen. And so anyway, Titus chapter number 1, let's pick up reading in verse number 5. We'll read down through verse number 8. For this cause left I thee in Crete, that thou shouldest set in order. The Bible tells us, let all things be done decently and in order. God is a God of order. God is a God of structure. Nothing takes God by surprise, but God wants things to be done decently in order within our churches, within our homes, and within our lives as children of God. That's why He gives us the Word of God. And one of the things that the Bible tells us the Word of God is given to us is instruction in righteousness. How to live after we get saved. Amen.
Amen.
Aren't you glad you have that from the Word of God?
Amen.
God doesn't leave us guessing, doesn't leave us speculating. He tells us what He expects and what we need to do. Praise be to God.
Amen.
For this cause I left thee in Crete, that thou shouldest set in order the things that are wanting, and ordain elders in every city as I had appointed thee. And notice here the qualifications start here in verse number 6. If any be blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of riot or unruly, for a bishop, notice here again the second time in 2 verses, must be blameless as the steward of God, not self-willed, not soon angry, not given to wine, no striker, not given to filthy lucre, but a lover of hospitality. Notice the change that takes place in verse number 8. But a lover of hospitality, a lover of good men, sober, just, holy, temperate. And we'll stop right there and ask the Lord to bless the reading of the Scriptures tonight, and then we'll look at some more of these qualifications this evening. Dear Heavenly Father, we are thankful for this time that You've allowed us to come together to worship Thee in spirit and truth. And Lord, we are thankful for the blessing of rain that You've sent to our area and to our community in this region. Father, we thank You, dear Lord, for these showers of blessings, Father, not only in the form of rain, but Father, for the food and for the clothes and for the health and breath of life that You've given us, Heavenly Father, and for Your Word. All the blessings and benefits that You freely bestow upon us each and every day, Father, we give Thee the thanks, honor, and praise to Thy blessed name. And Father, we thank You for Your Word and for the instruction and truths that we receive from Thy Word. And Lord, as we look to the bread of life tonight, Father, I pray that You would feed our spiritual souls as we look at the qualifications of the elders, the pastor, and the bishop. Heavenly Father, Lord, I pray tonight that You would open up our ears and our hearts to the preaching and teaching of Thy Word, and that we would learn something tonight to help us in our daily walk with Thee. And Father, that we would understand what Your expectation is for these individuals that hold these positions. And Lord, I pray that You would help me tonight as I preach Thy Word. Father, I pray that You'd give me the anointing of the Holy Ghost to preach with clarity of thought and clarity of speech. Please strengthen my voice and my lungs that I may be able to declare Thy blessed Word. And Father, if there's one here tonight that's in our midst, that's lost and without Christ, Father, I pray that You convict their heart of sin, that You draw them to Yourself, and that they would come forward this evening and call upon the name of the Lord and be saved before it's eternally too late. And Lord, we just thank You and praise You for what You've done. And Lord, we thank You and praise You for what You're going to do. For it's in Christ's name we do ask it all. And amen. Verse number 8, last week we talked about that a lover of hospitality and a man of God truly needs to be hospitable to those that are around him, whether it be his family or his neighbor or a stranger, whatever the case may be. Beloved, he's to be in the attitude of friendliness and courtesy and show respect to those that he encounters. And then notice here the next thing, and this is what we'll pick up with this evening, a lover of good men, a lover of good men. The word translated here for lover of good men is philagathos. In other words, he's to be a lover of anything that is good. If you remember the Apostle Paul, as he wrote to the believers in the book of Philippians, if you remember Philippians chapter number 4, verse number 8, early on in chapter number 3, the Apostle Paul, you know, he had a past that followed him around. And maybe, friend, you have a past that follows you around. Beloved, there's some things that I've done in my past that I'm not proud of. Quite honestly, I'm ashamed. And if I could turn back time, or if God would allow me an opportunity to travel back in time, there are some decisions that I would definitely change and do a lot of things, if you will, differently. And I think all of us here tonight would testify of that fact, that there are some things that we would do differently if we could do them again. And of course, the Apostle Paul was a Pharisee of the Pharisees. He was very knowledgeable. He was confident in his flesh. He persecuted Christianity and persecuted the early church and had believers jailed and had them placed to the point to where they could be put to death because of their faith in Jesus Christ. But praise be to God. He got saved on that road to Damascus. And by the way, that's what our nation's on, the road to Damascus.
Yes.
You'll get that here in a minute. In regard to the COVID, Damascus. All right, moving right along. On the road to Damascus, he met the Lord. Praise be to God. Amen. Praise God for that. And he got saved and got born again. Well, now, beloved, now you think about that. And you know, this is just a way, beloved, that our flesh operates or seems to operate. When somebody's name is mentioned and it's somebody that you have a relation with or that you've encountered or you know something about them, it seems like the first thing that comes to mind or to remembrance most of the time is some of the negative things that they have done in their life. Tonight, if I mention the name David, usually the first thing that comes to a person's mind is his sin with Bathsheba. We all call her remembrance. Oh yeah, he's the one that sinned with Bathsheba. But you know, the Bible also records about the same man that he was a man after God's own heart. And beloved, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think there's no other individual in Scriptures that's mentioned about a man after God's own heart is King David. And so, beloved, we have a tendency to focus on the negative things. And you can only imagine what the Apostle Paul, beloved, was thinking as he went through all these regions and areas where he had persecuted Christians and Christianity and had them jailed or had them sentenced to be murdered. And then you come across the same crowd. Well, you know, hey, this guy, you know, better watch out for him. Last time he was here, my cousin, he jailed them. He had one of my family members killed because of their faith in Jesus Christ. And now he's holding the tent meeting over here, preaching the name of Christ. That's just a ploy to get us all together. That's just a ploy to get us all together. He's going to throw us all in jail. Don't think he did not have to deal with that from area to area as he went through his missionary trips, if you will. And so, if you notice in chapter 3, verse number number 12, he says, not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which I also am apprehended of Christ. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. Now get this, mark this in your Bible, this will help you in your daily walk with the Lord. Forgetting those things which are behind. What's done is done. You and I cannot travel back through the portal of time. We can't do what's already been done, but we can purpose in our heart to forget those things which are behind. Amen. The Bible says, Jesus Christ mentioned that no man with his hands to the plow looking back is fit for the kingdom of heaven. Don't think about your past mistakes. Don't dwell on past failures. Forget those things which are behind. Look forward. Keep your hands to the plow and keep your eyes on Jesus Christ. So notice here, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended or to have arrived. He said, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. The Apostle Paul realized he'd been saved. There were some things he couldn't change, but there was rewards that awaited him and all of us if we'll press forward and look forward and do the will of God in our life. Amen. And so as we fast forward now to chapter number 4, he tells us some things to occupy our mind with. We are engaged, beloved, in real spiritual warfare tonight. And the warfare is not out here in the yard. It's not at your home. It's not at work. The warfare that takes place for the believer takes place right here in the mind.
Amen.
It takes place in the mind. Now notice here, let's back up to verse number 6, chapter 4, verse number 6. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God. Notice the result of this. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds. How about that? Shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, notice the command, think on these things.
Amen, Lord.
And let it, when you let your thoughts and affections and set your mind upon godly things and upon Jesus Christ, you won't have time to worry about your past or the storms and trials and tribulations that surround you. Praise be to God.
Amen. Amen.
And so, beloved, we need to set our thought and mind upon godly things. And so as we go back to our text now, but a lover of hospitality, a lover of good men, or a lover of good things, beloved, we need to set our thoughts and affections upon godly, Christ-like things, beloved. And that's what the man of God should do as an elder or pastor of the church. Beloved, he ought to enjoy and look forward to all those things that are good. Amen. And be a lover of all those things that are good. Beloved, any man of God that comes up and compromises the Word of God and pets sin on the head and compromises the truth of the Word of God and say, well, that's okay, that's not that bad, that's not what you're looking for. Beloved, need to have one that will stand upon the Word of God and declare the truth of God's Word and not be afraid of persecution and don't apologize for what thus saith the Lord declares.
Amen,
beloved, today it just irritates me. It irritates me in the flesh when I see the liberal media and a bunch of left-wing groups out there that call Christianity hate speech and call us evil. And we shouldn't be surprised. Jesus Christ said, hey, the world's persecuted me, and those that follow me, you're going to receive persecution as well. That shouldn't surprise us. The world hated him so much that they said, crucify, crucify, give us Barabbas. They'd rather have a murderer than have the Lamb of God and have the truth in their life. Men love darkness more than they love light. And of course, that goes with our spiritual condition. And you have the quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins. Beloved, we inherit a sin nature and we are dead spiritually. That's why we need to be born again. That's why the Bible says, and you have the quickened. The word quickened means to be made alive. And so, beloved, we live in a day and age where they're calling good evil and evil good. We shouldn't be surprised of that. Why? Because God has told us that that's what's going to take place. But even though that is taking place, as a child of God, that gives us no excuse to compromise and change our convictions and come off the truth of the Word of God. The Word of God is forever settled in heaven. And so, beloved, accept God's Word as truth. Stand on the truth and don't waver from it.
Amen.
Don't waver from
Amen.
It. So, preacher, I don't want to make somebody mad. Listen, you're going to make them mad no matter what. So, might as well just make them mad. I heard someone say, well, you never have to apologize when you're right. Listen, ain't people come up to me all the time and say, preacher, what about this? What about that? Listen, I don't have to defend God's Word at all. God takes care of His Word Himself. All I need to do is declare God's Word, and the Holy Spirit will take care of the rest of it in that person's heart. Amen. And so, beloved, a lover of good things, a lover of good men, a lover of good things. And notice here, the next thing that's mentioned here, in verse number 8, the word sober. Now, beloved, we talked about not giving to wine a few weeks ago, and that's not what that's making reference to here. But the word sober comes from the Greek word sophrena, which literally means to be a master of self. In other words, he's to demonstrate self-control. beloved, exercise restraint in his life. The Bible tells us in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse number 13, wherefore gird up the loins of your mind. Uh-oh. Guess where it starts at? It starts right here in the mind. Be sober and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Beloved, as a man of God and as a child of God, we're to be alert to our spiritual surroundings. Beloved, you need to be alert in regard to your physical surroundings. You don't know who's around you, what they're plotting to do, what they're thinking about doing. I remember when me and Christy first got married a few years ago and everything, we would be sitting at different places. And not that I'm a people watcher or anything like that, but when you're sitting there and there's activity around you, you know, it's just human nature to be sitting around and watching what other people are doing and everything. And Christy, she would be out shopping or be out with her friends or whatever, and I'd just be sitting over there just enjoying the rest and the relaxation and everything. And I told her one time, I said, now Christy, I said, you've got to be more alert of your surroundings and what's going on around you. I said, you're getting too caught up in self, getting too caught up in the moment of what you're doing. I said, you always need to be cognizant of who's around you and what's going on around you. Case in point, don't know if you follow NASCAR or not, and that really is not the relevant thing here, but there was an event that was held up at State Street. One side of the street's Virginia, the other side is Tennessee, up in Bristol, Tennessee, or Bristol, Virginia, depending on what side of the street you're on. They had a bunch of race car drivers up there, and me and Christy was up there walking. Place was crowded, shoulder to shoulder, and all of a sudden, here comes a race car driver walking down the sidewalk. This guy's 6'5". How can you miss him? You know? And so I sidestep him. I get around him. And the next thing I know, boom! You know? And I'm like, oh man, somebody just got punched. And I turned around. It was my wife. She walked into Michael Waltrip head on. He didn't see her, and she didn't see him. And of course, his wife, at the time, I guess he's still married to a lady by the name of Buffy. His wife was on the other side of him. And he said, I'm sorry. And I'm like, Lord, Michael Waltrip, he's even having wrecks off the racetrack. He has enough of them on the racetrack. He's having them off the racetrack. And I told Christy, I said, case in point, watch what you're doing. In other words, be sober, be cognizant of your surroundings. And as a shepherd, beloved, it is my responsibility, if you will, to look out for the spiritual well-being of the sheep, beloved, to watch the congregation, to be sure that there's no wolves that may come into the congregation to cause division, to cause discord. Now, beloved, we certainly want to welcome everybody that comes in to our church and make them feel welcome and have proper fellowship with them. But as a spiritual leader of the church, to identify those that maybe are trying to cause division or plant the seeds of apostasy or a false doctrine to get the church to branch off and this individual amass a following, if you will. You see. And so, beloved, you wonder why there's so many churches today? That's how they come about. It's for that very reason. That's how they come about. And so, beloved, the Bible tells us, 1 Peter chapter 4, verse number 7, but the end of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore sober and watch unto prayer. Beloved, if you're not for sure of what's taking place, commit it to God in prayer. Amen. And ask God to give you wisdom. Ask God to give you direction in regard to your circumstance and your surrounding and what's taking place, you see. And again, in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse number 8, be sober, be vigilant. Why? Because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. And beloved, the devil, if he could tonight, he'd kill every one of us here that's saved tonight. He'd kill every one of us if he could. But thank God for that hedge of protection. Amen. That's about us. Beloved, God does keep a hedge of protection about his children. If you don't believe that, you need to go read the book of Job. Amen. The devil can only do what God will allow him to do. He's not all powerful. God is the one that's all powerful. And the devil only does what God will allow him to do. Amen. Again, this is reiterated in regard to being sober-minded, if you will, or mastery of self. Beloved, if a man of God doesn't look out for his own spiritual well-being, how can he do it for the body of Christ,
Amen.
You see?
That's true, brother.
And so if he can't recognize the dangers within his own heart,
yeah.
How is he going to lead a congregation, you see?
Amen.
And beloved, I try to be everybody's pastor here. I try to be everybody's friend here. And some of y'all know this. Now listen, there's time to preach. Right now I'm preaching to you. But now some of y'all have went through some trials, have went through some difficulties, and by God's leading, I picked up the phone and called, and you say, I wish the preacher would call me. God answered your prayer. Or maybe there's something going on in your life and you've called me and been able to reach me and we've talked about some things and you know this. I'll say, now look, I'm not going to preach on you real hard here, but I'm trying to be your friend and I'm trying to be your brother in Christ. I'm trying to help you and give you godly instruction from the Word of God because I care for your spiritual well-being.
Amen.
I want to see God bless and work in your life.
Amen.
You know, some shepherds, that might not be a priority in their top 10 list of things that they want to try to accomplish in their ministry. But a man of God is concerned about the spiritual well-being, not only for himself and his household, but his church.
Yeah.
You see, the body of Christ that the Lord has put him over, if you will, as far as a local New Testament assembly. And so, again, we see this qualification mentioned in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse number 2. A bishop then must be, blameless. And, of course, we've already talked about blameless. It's mentioned twice. Must be pretty important because it's mentioned here in 1 Timothy as well. Must be blameless. Not should be. He must be. Big difference between the two. The husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach. And in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 6 through 8, the Word of God tells us, therefore let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. For they that sleep, sleep in the night, and they that are drunken in the night. But let us, talking about the redeemed now, talking about the saved, I'm branching this out just a little bit, this truth here, but let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. Beloved, if you're saved, you're of the day, you're no longer in darkness, you're in light now, praise be to God. And he's saying, be sober, be vigilant. Why? What's mentioned here? The armor of God. You're going to be engaged in real spiritual warfare. You better equip yourself. You better look out, because there's a real enemy out there. We're fighting spiritual wickedness in high places. Hey, the enemy's real tonight. The fight's real tonight. But praise be to God. We have victory in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Praise be to God.
That's right.
And so, beloved, notice here, sober. In other words, mastery of self or exercising some self-restraint. And then notice the next thing that's mentioned here in verse number 8 is just. This comes from the Greek word dikaios, I believe, is the pronunciation on that, or that's the best I can do with it. But in other words, he's honest in his relationship and dealing with other men. With other men. Beloved, in other words, he needs to protect his testimony, amen? And he needs to be honest with all those that he encounters, whether they're saved or whether they're lost. Beloved, the devil sometimes will jump up on your shoulder and say, you know what, this person doesn't know this. This person doesn't know that. They'll never find out. They'll never understand. And so go ahead and take advantage of the situation and the circumstance. Beloved, let me tell you something. You better be sober. You better put on the armor of God. You better guard against that type of temptation. And beloved, today, we are lived in a society where people prey on the ignorance and the lack of knowledge of other people. If you don't think that's true, turn on the news about every week. They'll say, if you get a phone call from the IRS, if you get a phone call from this government agency, it's a scam, it's not real, it's not true. I probably got about 200 numbers blocked on my phone. This is the warranty service. and the warranty on your car has expired. Amen. You need to renew that. And every time that number comes up, I let it do its thing. I fight it, block it, and guess what? I don't know how many phone numbers they can get. I've only got one phone number, and I have a hard time keeping up with that. But they get all these phone numbers, and they call back the next day, and the next day. And so the block list, I've got so many numbers on there, I don't know who they belong to. They're just blocked because I'm not interested in a warranty. I had one day, and Lord forgive me, I shouldn't have done this. But called me up at work. It was already an intense day. I was already tired. I was already frustrated. And then the phone rings. And they've got to where they're using local numbers or local area codes now. Yeah. I better take this one. Hello? Yes, I just want to let you know that your credit card has been compromised, and we need to act quickly to protect any further loss and protect you from damage. I said, really? I said, which one? And he said, well, is this card here? And I said, really? Tell me what's going on. Well, I need to know who I'm talking to. And I said, well, I said, you're the one that called me. I mean, you called me with a financial crisis and you don't know who you're talking to? I said, what kind of operation is this? I said, what's your name? Sir, I'm just trying to help you out. And I said, well, tell me which credit card it is. And he said, well, sir, we need to try to figure out that information. I need your credit card information to verify which card it is. And I said, I've got so many to choose from. We ain't got all day. Lord, forgive me, I shouldn't have said that, because I do not own a credit card. I don't. Now, I've got a Lowe's card. I've got a Home Depot card. And I have a debit card, which technically, and I was trying to justify this, can be used as a credit card. You know, and I said, look, I said, buddy, I don't have a credit card. I said, you're a scam artist, and I'm going to report you. Click! Well, anyway. Beloved, you need to be prepared for what's going on around you, amen? Because people try to take advantage of you if they can.
Yes,
but notice here, we go back to our text, sober and just. I think that's where we're at about today. We're talking about sober. I know we're down to just now. I'll catch up here in a second. And everything. But the Bible tells us in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse number 7, moreover, he must have a good report of them which are without, lest he fall into reproach and snare of the devil. Now notice what the text tells us here. Moreover, he must have a good report of them which are without. Now he's not talking about the poor and the needy. Jesus Christ said, you'll always have the poor and the needy with you. You're always going to have that. Those that are without, he's talking about those that are without Christ, without salvation. Man of God has to have a good report, not only amongst believers, but he must have a good report of those that are unbelievers, the lost and the regenerate. In other words, he needs to be given hospitality to those that are lost. He needs to show love and courtesy and respect to those that are lost, to try to win them and that they can see Christ in him and that he's real and that he can change and transform lives. You see. And again, in Colossians chapter 4, verse number 5, the Word of God tells us, walk in wisdom for them that are without, redeeming the time. Walk in wisdom for them that are without. Beloved, let me tell you something. If there's one thing that all of us, not only as an elder of a church, but all of us as children of God, if there's one thing that we need to exercise, one thing that we need to do is redeem the time. Redeem the time. Now, beloved, we all are guilty to some degree, to some extent, in regard to wasting time on entertainment and frivolous things that will not amount to anything for eternity. We're all guilty of that. Beloved, the fact of the matter is, walk in wisdom toward them that are without. When the Holy Spirit of God impresses upon you to witness to somebody or gives you that opportunity to be a witness and to be a light, you need to redeem the time and take advantage of that door of utterance that God has given you to share the gospel message of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And beloved, if you say, preacher, I'm not good at speaking, I may not have all the scriptures memorized. Let me tell you something. That's okay. That's okay. Because if you truly are saved and you're truly born again, all of us have this, a testimony of what God has done for you and how he has changed and transformed your life.
Amen.
And beloved, if you don't have a testimony of salvation and how God's changed your life, the altar's here tonight. You need to get on the altar because there's a heart problem there. You may not be saved. But there's one thing that the Apostle Paul done that we have record of in Scripture is when he was bound before his accusers. Beloved, yes, he did at times preach to them. He did share scriptural truth with them. But we find that the Apostle Paul was consistent in sharing his Damascus Road account in front of those that accused him. He told them of what happened to him when he got saved and got born again on the road to Damascus. How he met the Lord and how the Lord changed him.
Amen.
It's a beloved. That's something all of us can share.
Yes.
And beloved, you don't have to have the Word of God to do that because that ought to come from the heart.
Right.
Ought to come from the heart. In dealings with other people, the man of God needs to be just and maintain his integrity and his testimony when he's dealing with other people, whether they're saved or whether they're lost.
That's right.
Whether they're lost. And then notice the last thing here, and we'll stop after this tonight, that's mentioned, the word holy. The man of God needs to make sure that his relationship with God is in its proper perspective and that he has the correct relationship with his heavenly Father.
Amen.
And so not only does the relationship with others need to be correct, his relationship with God must be correct as well. And let me tell you something. If a man's relationship and fellowship, if you will, is not right with God, he's not going to be right with his fellow man. If you're out of fellowship with God as a believer, you're going to be out of fellowship with other individuals, whether they're saved or they're lost, because you know that God's dealing with your heart about something. And there may be something you need to repent of, something you need to ask for forgiveness of, or maybe you're simply being disobedient to the command of God in your life. There's an individual that's here tonight that shared this testimony with me today. Been running from God for 20-something years.
Yes.
God's called him to do something. And he's been running like Jonah all this time. And we all know that saying, you can run, but you can't hide from God.
Right.
You know what? When you go, if you were to try to hide from God, you're in this auditorium. Hey, preacher, I'm going to run to the ladies' Sunday school class back there and try to hide. Let me tell you something. When you open up that door, God's already there.
Right.
If you try to run over here to my office tonight and try to hide from God, as soon as you open up that door, guess what? God's already going to be there to meet you. Wherever you're running to, God's going to be there. For the gifts and calling of God are without what? Repentance. And so, beloved, you cannot experience true joy, true happiness as a believer unless you're in a proper fellowship with your Heavenly Father.
Amen.
And so, notice here, the Word of God tells us here in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 18 through 20. Flee fornication. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body, but he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God, and you are not your own? For you are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Beloved, there was a problem at the church of Corinth. There was some misconduct and some sexual sins that were taking place within the church. But yet they felt like that they were saved. And the Apostle Paul addressed this. He said three very important words. Be not deceived.
Yeah. Amen.
And beloved, people that practice these lifestyles, and they say, oh, preacher, I'm saved. Everything's okay. I'm going to heaven. God loves me. Well, I'll agree with part of this. God does love you. He loved mankind so much that he gave his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross of Calvary and taste death for every man, that you may be reconciled back to the Father through the Son.
Amen.
Now, I'll agree with that part of it.
Yeah.
But God's also a God of judgment.
Yeah.
And the Bible says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And so, beloved, sin will be judged. And if you think you can go out and continue living in sin and you call yourself a child of God and there's no chastening, there's no contrition, there's no chastisement, let me tell you something. You are deceived and you must be born again.
Amen.
And so, beloved, there's a lot of people out here, I believe. Now, listen, I can't see that person's heart. And what took place in their heart, only they and God truly know. But let me tell you something, when people profess that type of lifestyle or lifestyles to me, that they're doing this and they're doing that, and I'll ask the question, does that not bother you?
Yes.
Is there not any guilt or contrition? No, preacher, everybody else is doing it. You know, and we use a different Bible than you do, and our Bible says that that's okay. Matter of fact, it doesn't mention anything at all about it. Well, you know, I know what the Word of God says.
Amen.
And I know that God has said, forever, O Lord, is thy word settled in heaven. And whether or not it is in your version or not, God has declared it sinful and wrong and has condemned that.
Amen.
And you need to ask for forgiveness. Amen. You need to get saved and repent and turn from that. Amen. And if you truly get born again, that's exactly what will take place.
That's right.
That's exactly what will take place. James chapter 1, verses 26 and 27 tells us, if any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, going back to that song that you sang a little bit earlier, and we went over this in our study in James, but notice this, if any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, guess what? He's deceiving himself. Man out here cussing like a sailor, using the Lord's name in vain, I'm going to heaven, preacher. And then he uses all these expletives after that. There's a heart problem there. He's deceiving his own heart. He's deceiving his own heart. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this: to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction. Now notice this. And to keep himself unspotted from the world. Beloved, you see how all these things begin to tie together now? He needs to have a right relationship, a right fellowship with his Heavenly Father. He needs to be in fellowship with God. He needs to be right with God. He needs to be right with fellow man and protect himself and keep himself unspotted from the world. That's how you stay blameless. That's how you remain blameless. See, God gives us the roadmap. God gives us the instruction on how to accomplish these things. We just got to read and study God's Word and do what God has told us to do. And then notice the last thing, and we'll stop here, is temperate. In other words, this comes from the Greek word, and I'm not even going to try to pronounce that. But anyway, in other words, he needs to be moderate in his desires and his actions and control himself. Beloved, in other words, don't get carried away. You're over here fishing, and the stripe are running, and you're catching them every cast. Well, you know what? I think I'll just cancel church tonight. These fish only run once a year, and I'm here right now. We'll just cancel church tonight. That's not controlling the lust of the flesh.
Nope.
You see. And so there's nothing wrong with catching fish. Jesus Christ said, I'll make you fishers of men. Beloved, I'm working on a message. I did this some time ago, and I've rediscovered this. Y'all don't think I'm crazy, but I have to make this a matter of prayer. Think about bringing a fishing rod in here one night, and where Jesus said, make you fishers of men, talk about the hook and the line and the rod and the reel, and show you their symbolism from Scripture. Now, I'm not going to say it's not anything new under the sun, but you certainly can make that application, beloved, just like the line. The line, you cast out the line, you give out the gospel message, if you will. You take the reel, and you reel the bait in, if you will. Well, that when you do that, you're drawing that line in. There's that drawing of the Holy Spirit, you see. And so I don't want to give it all away. You won't come back for that. But I'll make that a matter of prayer and everything. I never have been one to use a lot of visual things in my preaching because I'm so easily distracted. I do well to maintain where I'm at. But anyway, exercise temperance or self-restraint in his own life and everything. And so we'll stop there and we'll pick up with verse number 9 next week. But you see how all these things are, you know, different but the same. They all come together. They all come together. And so we'll stop right there tonight. And Brother Larry, if you'll make your way up to the instrument, I'd like to invite everybody, if you would, to stand, please. Everyone standing, everyone's heads bowed, everyone's eyes closed. I want to ask a question here this evening. Maybe there's someone here tonight and the Holy Spirit of God has spoken to your heart.